Score, the podcast. The only show taking you inside the studios of the world's most celebrated composers and musical storytellers. Presented by Spitfire Audio.
Yes.
What an exciting week.
The Emmys are out.
We're
halfway there on the predictions. This is Score the Podcast, presented by Spitfire Audio. I'm Kenny Holmes. He's Robert Kraft.
Robert Kraft's in a little... Listeners, you know, we had an online poll who you thought would predict the most winners. I lost resoundingly. And yet...
No faith in the Kraft.
I'm saying you got to ride or die with me, because I'm right up in the lead there. I have some ties with me, so I didn't crush it. But
it is, it's all knotted up. And composer Carol on the mic.
Hey there.
Oh, wow.
A lot of excitement.
So excited.
She's in the three-way tie right now.
Yeah.
It's we picked seven categories last week.
Yep.
And four of them have been announced. And the three of us are tied with two out of four. And poor Mash Raider, he only has one correct answer. So
He's hiding. I'm not taking him to Las Vegas.
What did he say? He's doing his sock drawer again.
That's right. He's got to reorganize his sock drawer. The good news for everybody, it seems that if you appear on Score the Podcast, I'm just saying, heavy metal is in your future. You take home an award.
It's a prerequisite, I think. You come on the show, you win an Emmy, and
batting 1,000. Four winners, all four guests. This season, I believe.
Well, if we got to reach out to Nick Britell.
Nick Britell coming up, and I'm pretty sure we're going to get him.
But we'll go through those in just a second. Again, we want to remind our listeners about Spitfire Audio, our presenting partner. If you're a composer listening right now, you probably already know about Spitfire Audio. Spitfire makes sample libraries for the world's leading film composers, including many of our guests on the show. Many of our Emmy-winning guests as well.
And they record at Air Studios, Spitfire does, where a lot of our Emmy Award-winning guests also record.
Yeah, one of the coolest studios in the world, right? Yep. In London, featured in the documentary. And it's an exciting time, too, because they just announced one of their newest packages, which is the BBC Symphony Orchestra.
Wow.
Which comes out on October 24th. And they did a whole keynote. It was cool. Like, they did it like an Apple keynote. Mm. And it's super exciting, and it's next level. I mean, this is you have the BBC Symphony Orchestra at your fingertips, so you want to make sure to pre-order that. You can go to spitfireaudio.com right now and pick that up. Carol, are you going to get that thing?
Yeah, I can't wait.
That's the right answer. We got to get you one so you can check it out.
There's tons of other packages, though, and you can't ever have enough samples in your library when you're writing music, because they give you all these tools. And what a time to be a composer, to have these tools right at your fingertips. You used to have to just scribble on paper and hope it sounds good later at the soundstage. So you can hear it all. And Spitfire has all these different packages. Albion One, which is kind of their starter package you can get. But we have a special offer for our listeners. If you use the promo code SCORE, you get a third off the price.
33.3%.
It's not 5%. It's not the tax. It's a third off, and it's a limited time only. So go check out SpitfireAudio.com if you're an aspiring composer or a composer kicking ass already.
Yeah.
Go check it out.
That would be a perspiring composer.
That's true. use that promo code while it lasts. Again, spitfireaudio.com, and use the promo code SCORE, and then stick around after the show today. We're going to play you a demo cue that they provide to us, so you can hear all the different types of sounds you can get with Spitfire.
So cool.
Carol's a Spitfire user.
Yeah. No, I love anything Spitfire. And yeah, that's not just because our show is sponsored by them. It's before doing Score, I've been using Spitfire.
It seems everybody does.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Most of the composers we talk to
are kind of industry standard right now.
Yeah. They're at the top of the game for sure. So check that out. And speaking of being at the top of the game, the Emmys came out. So let's break it down here. So the four categories that got announced over the weekend are the music the composers. We picked, of course, three shows, the comedy, the drama, and the miniseries also, which is part of the primetime broadcast next week. But for now, let's talk about the winners. So we had miniseries, which was our friend of the show, Hildur Guðnadóttir.
Go Hildur!
Her incredible work with Chris Watson.
You can hear her voice.
It was so cool to see the posts online, how happy she was. What a year. She's on...
She's got Joker coming up.
It's going down, man.
I think October 4th release. And I'm happy to also share with our listeners, if you happen to be in Ghent, Belgium, for the World Soundtrack Awards on October 17th, it's a Thursday, I'm going to be interviewing Hildur at the World Soundtrack Awards. We're going to do a one-on-one Q&A with the audience to talk about her remarkable career and what's ahead, because you can imagine this is somebody who's really setting a benchmark for all composers. She's brilliant.
Very cool. And your interview's already warmed up. And if you haven't listened to our interview with Hildur earlier this season, you can find it. Just scroll back. I think it was like the sixth or seventh episode of season two.
Yeah.
So we're excited for Hildur and what's to come. But she's already taken home a statue this awards season. Which
I really can't wait to see and hear Joker. I must admit, very few movies have gotten me this, you know, like I'm going to go Thursday night at midnight before it comes out.
And how could I forget, our guest this week is Marco Beltrami. Just so the audience is aware, we interviewed Marco the day before he won the Emmy for Free Solo. We didn't really want to jinx it, so we didn't talk about
Emmys.
You'll
hear, we really skirted around the issue of the Emmys because it was a Friday and he was going on Saturday. I think off mic I said, you know, do you have a little remarks prepared? And he said, you know, I don't think I'm going to win. There's really nothing to prepare. Boom. He nailed it. And listen to this music. He deserved that award.
Yeah, it's a great score. I just picked up the vinyl. So our guest this week is Marco Beltrami.
Yep.
And we're going to talk about Free Solo coming up in just a bit. And, of course, his amazing path through the horror genre with Wes Craven and Scream, and he also worked with Guillermo del Toro.
Yep.
And he's got Ford v Ferrari coming out later this year, which is killing it in the circuit.
Yeah.
So congrats to Marco and Hildur, and then of course my prediction from last year finally came true. It was a no-brainer.
Even hearing this gives me a kind of nervous in my tummy feeling. There's such a feeling in this show, Succession.
I just want to go buy a mansion when I hear this song.
That's funny.
Just feel powerful and rich, and oh man, it's
yeah. Nick Bertel really hitting it out of the park with this theme. He won for best theme, and
season two is on fire already.
On fire.
Of this show. If you're not watching it, it's one of the best shows on TV.
Jump in there.
So congrats to Nick as well, and then Carol with the big prediction on the dramatic score with Ramin Djawadi.
G-O-T.
Game of Thrones.
Taking it home. I mean, Ramin, needless to say, is just doing an incredible job with that show. He's probably increased his fan base exponentially through the live shows that he does, the Game of Thrones tour.
And he's got Jack Ryan season two coming out.
Just crushing it. And
and check out our interview with Ramin if you haven't, from last season.
Yes, and I think if you ask any of these composers, they will all admit that their career was slightly hanging in the balance until they did an episode of Score the Podcast, and boom, awards, listen to the audience.
That's very true.
Paparazzi track them wherever they go. So
And many of the nominees as well, guests on the show, and you know, I want to reiterate that all these composers are so busy and they took the time to come on the show, and they're part of the Score the Podcast family now. And we're super excited for the winners and the nominees, and just all around kudos to everybody who's just killing it out there and making great music for the shows and movies that we watch.
I think if it's any indication of how great their music is, our votes were completely divided. And here we listen to Score and television, music all the time, and we couldn't decide. Was it going to be Benjamin Wallfish, Stephen Price? There were so many great contenders for these awards. So,
David Arnold,
Yep.
So it's going to be interesting this weekend with the actual Emmys to see who takes home the prize of the score of the podcast fake Emmys,
actually. These aren't the real ones.
The primetime Emmys, prime the creative. Time. They split it up. But I think they're airing the broadcast of the Creative Arts on Saturday, the night before the primetime Emmy, the main broadcast.
I'd like to see what some of them said.
Yeah, I wanted to hear some of the speeches. So we'll try and maybe we can pull a couple clips of some good speeches.
I gave Marco, I said as I was leaving on Friday, just of course not as part of the podcast, but I said to him, listen, if you win, just get up there and say, this means nothing to me. And then I asked
him. He did say that, by the way. I heard him that.
On Sunday, I said, did you do what I said? He said, no, I think I'm going to save it for next year. So
again, congrats to everybody, and exciting weekend ahead with the primetime broadcast. And we're going to take a quick break, and then it's time to head over to Malibu, to Pianella Studios, for our interview with Marco Beltrami. Stick around, we'll be right back. Hey, Score fans, it's Kenny Holmes. We're back to the show in just a second. Just a quick reminder, be sure to follow us on Twitter, at Score the Podcast. We post a lot of behind-the-scenes videos, and we'll also keep you up to date on who our next guest is. So make sure to go over and follow us now. Welcome back to Score the Podcast, presented by Spitfire Audio. We're here inside Pianella Studios. Is that how I pronounce it?
You did well.
Perfect. And our guest today is two-time Oscar-nominated composer Marco Beltrami, who let us come to his fortress here in the outskirts. Are we, Robert, does this feel like your trip to the Serengeti a little bit? We're in the middle of nowhere.
Actually, the Serengeti feels very familiar. This is so remote, but so beautiful. Marco, you've really built a wonderland here. I'm sure everyone feels it, which is also phenomenally inspiring, I would think, to be in and write here. I've always felt that when I come here, which is you see these beautiful views, you drive past the ocean.
The blanket of clouds we saw on the way in.
I like it here. The drive for me is a chance to decompress and from everything that happens during the day. Actually, it's funny you say, does this remind you of Africa? We do have some wildlife here. In fact, just last week we had a mountain lion in the
yikes.
That they're afraid of people. You know, it was really hard. You feel sort of lucky if you can see one. We have bobcats all the time that you see, but mountain lion was really cool.
That's amazing. I do wonder. I mean, you and I have sort of talked about this a little bit, but did you always have an instinct to go remote? To be creative? I mean, can you think of...
You know, so much of what we do is exploration of sounds. And before we were at I think you were there. We met. I was at a little studio in the back of the house in Malibu. Yep. And then we had another place also on PCH. And it was just impossible to really experiment too much because you had always had noise. Street noise, helicopter noise, whatever. So one of the things about this place was that it was so remote for the creative sense. The other was that it was so remote, it's going to take people really going to want to have to come up here.
Yeah.
Meaning producers and, you know, it has to be a, there's no last minute pop-ins.
You have to commit.
No pop-ins. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's also great when we record here, the musicians sort of plan a day and, you know, so we provide catering, provide food, and it's sort of a nice excursion. You know, it's not run from here and do something else. It's an outing.
It's focused. It's wonderful. And
there's no cell service either. So it's, you're focused out here.
Yeah. I mean, we do have a cell service, but I mean, you have to actively connect to it.
Do you find yourself staying day and night, or can you pull yourself away and end your day and go be with the fam?
I usually do. I mean, sometimes I'll stay up here, and sometimes even on the weekends, the family will come up. We have you may have seen it up there, a little guest house overlooking the water. And it's a great place to hang. I mean, you saw those clouds. Sometimes the clouds rise and they come right to the doorstep and you feel like you're just like up in heaven.
It's remarkable. And it makes me wonder, as I look down this phenomenal list of films, so many of which I have loved and even a couple we've been lucky enough to work on together. In fact,
the beginning of my career.
You might be worth reminding me how you remember that moment, because I very distinctly remember where and how we got started together. What is your memory of it?
Well, first of all, my memory of everything these days is sort of vague because
joining the club.
I have very bad insomnia, so I take a lot of Ambien, and I think it affects my memory. But I do remember that I was very excited because this movie from a director that I knew at the time, Alex Proyas, was looking for a score. And when I got a call to come in and meet him and meet you, and I think, you know, it felt like a huge break to me. I had done Scream, I had done some other movies, but I really hadn't done any studio work, I don't think, outside of Miramax Dimension. So this was like a big moment for me. I was very excited.
You probably don't remember, because I probably don't remember. We had just met shortly before. We had met, it's the best situation of all, which is sort of last in, remains in your mind. Marco had come to my office at Fox 2 weeks before, just on a general meet and greet.
Huh.
2 or 3 weeks before you'd come in. In the interim, we're trying to get iRobot together, and Alex Proyas, the director, is very frustrated with his current composer. And I don't know how much of that you knew, but I actually flew to London in this kind of desperate bottom of the ninth, last-ditch effort to rescue a score and a composer, and it didn't work.
Were they already recording?
They hadn't recorded. Okay. He was sending demos. They weren't working. Hmm. Great composer, but it just wasn't. The
fit was wrong.
Fit was wrong, and on a Sunday night at a preview in Marina Del Rey, Alex Proyas says very casually, as we're in the lobby after the movie, he goes, you know, I'm not going to use one note of the music I've been sent.
Wow.
Everybody leaves and I panic because it's 28 days until the recording session and the movie's coming out. It's Will Smith. It's on those bus stops.
Blockbuster.
Around. Yeah. And the guy says he's not going to use the music. What do we do? The next morning, I called you.
Wow. And I tried. Thank God I had that meeting with you, because otherwise I wouldn't have been right in your head.
No, you were in my head as like the last guy, and you seemed kind of cool, and I liked what you'd written. And I played something maybe for Alex that night and said, I have an idea, and it's somebody that I think would be right, and I feel confident, which is always a good thing to say when, you know, inside you're kind of hoping Marco Beltrami is like the guy who's going to knock it out. And you did the smartest thing ever. And I'll tell you, if you don't remember this, it's one of my favorite memories. I called you and said, hey, Marco, trying to remain really calm because it was just cold sweat time.
Yeah.
What are you doing this morning? Could you come see a movie at Fox on the studio lot with me and Alex Broyas? You said, when do you want me there? I said, how soon can you get here? And this was like 9:30 in the morning. And you said, I'll be there around 11. Alex Broyas actually comes to the music building to meet you with me.
I remember that.
We're standing on the steps, and you pulled up on a motorcycle with a black helmet and a black visor. And Alex Proyas looked at me with this kind of thumbs up look like, I don't have to hear anything. That's my guy. He just looked so badass, so and funny. You looked like a character out of iRobot. We went to the movie. You had some really good ideas. And I said, you know, we got 28 days. You got to write everything. Maybe a day or two later, you turned in the theme.
We had 28 days till
delivery.
I had 17 days to write the score.
You're right. We had to start recording in 17 and deliver.
See, that I remember because that's imprinted in my mind.
I thought either this guy, who I've never worked with, I mean, it's kind of a lesson in don't do this at home. You want to go with the guy that's proven, the young lady that has scored something for you you know will deliver. I went way out on a limb and on a gut, and thank God you not only delivered, you crushed it.
This was my opportunity. If I blew this, you know, I wouldn't be working for Fox after that. You know, this was really my moment. So there was no way that I was going to blow this.
You turned in that violin theme upside down or backwards or something 2 days later, and I was like high-fiving everybody then.
Yeah. I remember you came over to my other studio there behind the house, I think with Alex maybe.
Maybe.
And I was so nervous. I'm like, yeah.
I think I was too.
And, yeah, and we played it, and...
Right, it's, by it's this point in the queue, I was saying.
Yeah, it's a voice mixed with a violin.
Oh, shit. Oh, yeah.
Nice. Clutch.
Fire, dude.
I remember this. This was back in the days when we had budget for scores and we could, it was...
Did we do this on the Fox stage?
Yeah.
But you done some pre-records.
Yeah, we did some stuff, like the violin stuff at my place, but it was such an intense experience doing this whole, there was a lot of music. I don't remember how much, but it was over an hour, probably close to 90 minutes of music.
It was huge. It was a huge job.
It was a huge job.
And you had to deliver it. You're right. Write it in 17 and...
Yeah. I have to say, well, first of all, that was great. I remember showing up on my bike. I remember being banned from going on the lot because the bike was too loud.
No.
and then me thinking, because I still had a reptilian brain back then. All right, I won't take the bike. I'll show these motherfuckers. And I showed up. The next time we had a meeting, I had an old Corvette that had glass pack mufflers on it, which was three times louder than the bike.
Perfect.
And I drove onto the lot, and the guy's like, "Huh? What? Who are you here to see?" And I, as I drove through, everybody's car alarm started going off.
Oh, perfect.
And I was driving to the stage, and I was like, "All right, that's payback."
Hey, I didn't bring a bike.
No, but
that's a rock star move right there. Oh, you don't like the bike? Wait till you see my little friend.
Yeah. But let me tell you in truth now, like those type of projects are the best. And I'll tell you why. You're writing the score really fast. There's no time for second guessing. And everybody is already sort of pre-required to love it. You know, it's there's no time for hemming and hawing, no time for try this, try that. It's, you go with your instincts. It's an opportunity for the composer because often we do go with our instincts, and our first instincts are, if there's too much time, you know, the director is like, oh, well, can we try this? Can we do that? But in this scenario, it's always been good for me. And flip side, when I have too much time on a score, and there are times when I've been fired too, the people that come in and replace me invariably have the same experience. Huh. So I just think it's very interesting. But I'm not complaining because it was such a door opening. But I'm just in the bigger perspective.
So you're using the deadline as a tool.
It's totally a tool, yeah. The only thing that would be a problem is after watching the movie, if I didn't have any ideas and I had to experiment. But I remember sitting in that theater, and before the movie was over, I knew what the theme was.
Oh.
Like, it was like I couldn't wait to get back and start working on it. And I think within, like, a day or two, I already had the theme to play for you guys. So if I had come out of that, be like, oh, no, what do I do now? Then it would have been a different situation, I think. But I think I was also predisposed to kick an ass on it. You know, I was like, this is,
right.
There's no way this is going to fail.
Somebody just said, you're about to go into the Super Bowl, suit up.
Yeah. And you don't fail.
Yeah, you said
came in with a loud vet, right. Just ready to fire.
I want to ask you a question about something you just said. Have you gone into any screenings where you the lights have come up and privately you're thinking to yourself, I don't know what to do?
Yeah.
And what do you, first of all, no directors can listen to this, so all directors close your ears. What do you say at that moment when the lights come up? What do you say to the director who looks at you with big expectation?
I find if I don't have ideas, that is usually a sign of troubles with the picture. Mm. There's something that's not grabbing me. It's not going to grab other people as well. Mm. And for me, it always spells trouble. Like, because if the picture is in trouble, music's always the last resort. People are always going to blame the music for fixing things and for not fixing things. And there's going to be an undue amount of scrutiny on the music. And that always makes me nervous. So, it has happened to me. Sometimes I'll look to the people around me, Buck, Brandon, Marcus, people that I work with, and start brainstorming.
Yeah.
And oftentimes, I have to say Buck is really good at this. Like he'll think of something in the movie that inspires me. And then we start talking about it and, we'll find a way to get inspired, but it's always a bad sign.
Can you talk a little bit about your connection with Buck and for the audience who doesn't know who Buck Sanders is, he's with you through everything.
Yeah. I met him when I was doing Scream. He was a friend of someone that was putting out my first score album for this TV show called Land's End. And he asked if his friend Buck could come to the scoring session. And after that, I said, yeah, I didn't know. Buck said, do you need an assistant? Do you need anything? I'm like, sure, I guess, and I was working out of the bedroom and, he came by to Xerox some scores. And before I knew it, I began to rely on him for his ears. I'd be playing a cue and be like, what do you think of this? And he would tell me, oh, well, this is cool, but I'm not sure this is working here or whatever. And he began to fill into a role. I'm really sort of technically inept. I know how to turn on a computer. I learned one program, Performer, before it had a digital attached to it. And that's it. And I still use that. But for things that I like to do, exploring sounds, manipulating acoustical sounds and coming up with new things, some things that composers do, I really have no skills at that. And Buck is really adept at that and enjoys it. And so we often work on a sort of composer-producer relationship, but then there's also projects that are very much geared to that, and we co-score them. The Hurt Locker was one of them. We were both nominated for that. And the latest film that we just did called Ford v. Ferrari, which comes out later this year, is another co-score that we did. So depending on our creative relationship, we often share credit. But yeah, we've been together for, I don't know, it's like a marriage.
So many questions. First of all, Hurt Locker and Ford v. Ferrari.
Which Ford v. Ferrari is, we talked a little bit about it.
I can't wait.
It's killing it in the festival circuit. And killing it. I can't wait.
I don't know if I'm biased because, I go to the track on Sundays with my son. We race and we ride. But I think it's the best movie I've ever done.
Oh God, that's so great. And you've done so many, and in the same breath as Hurt Locker, which was incredible. The two things that are similar about those pictures, and particularly tricky for a composer, they're both loud movies. And I got to imagine Ford v. Ferrari, you're weaving in and out of some engine sounds the whole time. Do you have to absolutely give it over to sound a lot of times?
Yeah, but the sounds of those cars are, it's like music to me.
Oh, yeah, I bet.
But, there are definitely moments that are, you want to hear the engines. But, also, the whole last third of the movie is a race. It's Le Mans. It's a 25-minute long race sequence. It can't be played just by engine sounds. There's an emotional context to it. There's a dramatic context, and the score has to weave with that. So, you know, you're feeling, look, it's not a terribly thematic score in terms of how you think. It's not a traditional score. It's not, there's no strings in it. There's, it's much more of like a 60s vibe band thing.
60s with, John Barry small band or Mancini kind of thing?
Yeah, like we had 15 players. We had we had three guitarists. We had a drum kit. We had electric bass. We had piano and B3. Huh. And we had a couple trombones and trumpets and that's the entire score. And we recorded the whole thing, not in stripes, but everybody there together at Capitol. And it has, so it's sort of rough around the edges. It's funny, I actually went and looked at footage of the actual 1966 Le Mans, a documentary on it. And I was like, I'm just curious, what kind of, did they put music with it? How'd they do this? And their ensemble is almost identical to what we did. And I was like, wow, that's really cool. Because I didn't look at that until after we were done with it. It was sort of the director's idea to try to do it a little bit differently.
Yeah.
So anyway, I think we're off our timeline here, but yeah.
No, can't wait. You actually, one other thing you said about how you are not sure what to do sometimes with certain pictures and you look to Buck or something. I thought you were going to say, you know, the lights come out and you say to the director, great costumes. I mean, you have to kind of fumble for, you know, the lighting's amazing in this movie.
I've definitely fumbled.
but you also reminded me of something that was said by someone that I didn't know until sort of reading back a little bit about you. And I've known you for so many years, but I don't think I knew that you first came out here and worked with Jerry Goldsmith. And he is the author of one of my favorite sayings about that expression, which he taught me. We worked on The Edge, which was a really weird movie with Alec Baldwin and Anthony Hopkins about a bear.
I didn't see it.
Oh, no one did. Jerry scored it. I had the opportunity to work with him on it. It was one of his last pictures. And we kind of acknowledge without saying it, because no composer will say to a studio dude, man, this is a stinker. He just would say, this movie, you know, they might be able to get, I hope they're going to be able to pull it together. And I said, yeah, but you got to score it. You got to score what's on the screen. He said, I always score the movie I want it to be. I thought, man, that's aspirational. You know, you're kind of telling yourself, well, this is funnier than maybe.
I love that about Jerry. By the way, I think it was that little bust on the piano that reminded you of Jerry, right?
Exactly right.
Yeah, because I saw you when you walked in. I saw you gave a two double glance.
How do you get a bust of Jerry Goldsmith?
I think I got a Jerry Goldsmith award from one of those
nice
festivals in Spain. But I think that's Jerry taught me really everything I know in terms of film scoring. I came from a classical concert background from Yale School of Music and came out here to work with Jerry. And I, coming from that world, we're hiding behind complexity in music. We're making things difficult and hard to play, hard to listen to. I mean, they have structure and they have integrity. But first thing Jerry said is you have to be economical. This has to be simple as possible for the desired result, both in terms of playability, but in terms of the idea. And I remember when I had to do The Omen for Fox, and Jerry, I'd studied Jerry's score for that, and you can reduce his score down to three notes. Mm-hmm. And pretty much everything in his score comes from those three notes. And I was, and still am, always have that in the back of my head, you know. But going to the point of what you said, because Jerry was a very frustrated guy too. And I found working with him that he could either be really exuberant and excited about ideas, but he could also get really depressed. And I find I fall into that trap
as
well. Well, and I think part of it is this idea of having your aspiration scoring the picture that you want it to be, because in the end, the picture will only support what it is. And there's plenty of awesome scores that Jerry did that are either too low in the mix or too chopped up or too edited or thrown out that really takes a toll, I think, on the creator. So I keep that in my mind, and I try to keep a distance from a certain emotional distance from pictures unless I really respond to them. And those that I do, I go full in. And those that I see that for whatever reason, we're not seeing eye to eye. My vision is not, I try to gauge it early on that, and then I look at what I need to do to service the picture, to get out unscathed and to stay, keep myself from getting jaded.
Do you have a favorite Jerry story? Something that you tell people?
Well, there's a lot of Jerry stories, but I was in a class at USC. Actually, Chris Beck was in my class. And he often would come in sort of grumpy. And one day he was particularly grumpy. It's like, kids today, nobody knows how to write a melody. Why is that? Nobody writes a melody. I want a 24-bar melody, you know, something that has an A theme, repeats, has a B theme, comes back to the A. And at the time, he was working on a movie called Matinee. It was an interesting class. He would be working on the movie. He would give the students in the class the same movie to work on. Like, we'd all have scenes. And then it was great because we'd work on our scenes. He'd go to record, and he would put up some of our cues with, you know, to, so we could hear them with the orchestra.
Wow.
And we were always, you know, sort of floored and be like, ah, shit, you know, this is the wrong job. I should be doing something else. Because he's, you know, again, the simplest way, we'd be writing around the block, you know, trying to figure out these complex solutions. And he was always succinct and simple and perfect for the scene. But in this one movie, Matinee, there's a character played by John Goodman. And for me, I saw him as sort of this larger-than-life sort of shady guy, and I wrote a tango for him. And so I remember when we recorded it afterwards, Jerry just looks at me, got off the podium, conducted, and he says, son of a bitch, he says, that's what I should have done. And I was like, wow, that's awesome.
That's so great. Yeah. What a great compliment from a teacher.
That was... Yeah.
You also just reminded me something that I'd never even conceived of as possible, either technically or musically, you did on The Omen. Do you know of which I speak, the cool thing you did on The Omen?
The piano pedal?
Yeah.
Oh.
So awesome. You want to just describe
that? Is
that
the cue you sent me?
I think it is, yeah.
A little hidden behind drums, but you can hear it.
I hear it.
What are we hearing?
There's another cue where it's more exposed.
Yes. It's the cue where he's riding the tricycle.
The tricycle, yes. Shit, it has a title. I forget what it is.
Murderous Kid on Trike. Mia Farrow sends him to kind of...
Yes.
Down the hallway.
Kill his mother. Yeah. There is very exposed in the beginning. Yeah. You can hear it, but... I have to say,
it's that sound.
I missed working for John Moore because, you know, I know his films, you know, might have some problems or whatever, but I've never met a more enthusiastic.
Sure was.
Both positively and negatively. There's no doubt about whether he liked something or didn't like it. And if he liked it, he would jump up. He would be like pumping the air with his fists. He'd be like screaming. If he didn't like it, he'd be like, you know, what, you know, this is crap, whatever. But when he liked it, so. just unambiguous. He was, I love working for him, and he really inspired me on the Omen to explore stuff. Like I was like, I showed him one day, I was like, I was thinking of, you know, sort of this diabolical breath type sound. And when you press the pedal and release it, it becomes not only rhythmical, but you hear the sustain of all the strings. And it almost has like a breath like sound.
It does. The pedal releases all the dampers of the piano strings, yeah. And you hear the kind of sound inside the cabinet for a minute.
Yeah.
And then you redamp it almost like a breath.
Exactly. And when I played that for him, he went over the moon and we were like, all right, well, this is definitely a sound.
Yeah, but you sampled it and made it rhythmic.
Yeah.
And turned that into drums, which I could hear in that cue.
Yeah, it was behind the drums. Yeah, in that one. Yeah. But
it was freaky.
That was fun.
We're going to talk a little bit more about horror, some Scream stuff, and also A Quiet Place. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll get to that and much more with Marco Beltrami. Stick around.
Hey, Matt Schrader here, director of Score, a film music documentary. For the latest news from the film music world, follow us on Facebook. Just search Score, a film music documentary. Or let us know who you want to hear next on the show on Twitter, at Score the Podcast.
Hey, this is Chris Lennertz, and you're listening to Score the Podcast. And now back to the show.
Welcome back to Score the Podcast, presented by Spitfire Audio. We're here with Marco Beltrami. This is one of the cool cues from Scream. Trouble in Woodsboro?
Yeah.
This cue always stood out to me, even when I first saw the film, because it's very experimental. There's so many different types of sounds. It's not the standard kind of horror sound you would hear.
Well, it's the first horror movie I'd ever seen.
Really?
Yeah.
So you had nothing to
You had no basis.
Yeah.
No. I had no idea what a horror movie was supposed to be or anything. I remember being in the first screening with Wes, and the beginning of the movie is all these self-referential jokes, I guess, about other horror movies, Nightmare on Elm Street and Halloween and all that, and I didn't get any of them. So I was sitting there very self-consciously not laughing next to Wes, who was, I think, wondering, like, what's going on? And I had to tell him, Wes, this is the first horror movie I've ever seen.
How did you get into a room with Wes Craven and not have ever seen a horror movie?
You know, Scream was a low-budget movie. It was the beginning of, they were just opening this Dimension branch at
Miramax,
yeah, run by Bob Weinstein. And Wes was having trouble finding a composer. You know, I don't know for what reason. I had done very little at this point. I had done a short movie for some students at USC. Kids at USC that I did this movie for went on, and there was a radio show back then called The Silver Screen, I think it was called. And they were interviewed on it. They were asked about the score because the music was really featured in their short movie. And let's see what happened. Wes Craven's assistant happened to be listening to the podcast and then was like, well, maybe Wes, we should try, you know, somebody else. So they asked me the next day, they somehow got my number and they said, would you put together a demo? This. And I didn't have anything that I thought was appropriate for a horror movie in an orchestral venue. I had a few concert pieces that I had little snippets of that might work, so I wrote some things, but they were unorchestral. I was like, instead of making this an orchestral demo and trying to copy like John Williams or anything like that, I'm going to lean into the fact that I don't have an orchestra, and I'm just going to rely on the sounds that I have. This is before I started making sounds, so these are all stock sounds from different libraries. But I'm just going to put together what I can, and I played it for Wes, and he thought it was really refreshing to hear a demo that stood out from all these fake orchestral sample things that he didn't really want in his movie anyway. So I met with him. We had a really good meeting. he screened the movie for me there. That's when I sat next to him, and I was sort of embarrassed. And then he said, listen, I can't just hire you for this movie because I don't know what, you know, but if you like, and this was on a Friday afternoon that I met him, he said, you can take home the opening of the movie. It's a scene where Drew Barrymore dies. It's a 13-minute long cue, the opening of the movie. Take this home, and if you can bring me back a score for it on Monday, then we'll play through it and see how it goes. So I was like, great. And I walked out of that meeting, and I was like, fuck. What the fuck am I going to do?
Yeah, no kidding.
So
I'm stressed out just hearing that.
So I called up Chris Beck, who had a studio, and I didn't.
Nice.
And I said, Chris, what are you doing this weekend? He's like, I don't know. I said, can I use your studio? And he said, yeah. So I went over to his place. I camped out at his for the whole weekend. And I recorded what I could. I did what I could. I'd never seen a horror movie. To me, it was the scariest thing watching, this girl get chased around. And so I scored it like I was in her shoes. You know, nice. I didn't have any references. And I went back to Wes, played it for him, and he was like, wow, this is different, very different from what I would expect. He said, but we're having a screening in New Jersey this week, a test screening. I want to cut your cue into the beginning of the movie, and let's see how it goes. And the movie went to New Jersey, Secaucus, New Jersey. I get a call from Wes after the screening. He says the movie got an 89, which was really good for, it was way over what they expected. So if you want the job, it's yours.
Jeez.
And I was like, oh, that's great. And then I have to say, I spent every penny. It was a $30,000 package.
Yeah.
I spent every penny and plus more recording it. We did it at the old Warner Brothers before they transformed it. Mm. And I even got Wes and the producers involved. There was one of the things in the score was I wanted it to be eerie. So with the string harmonics, I have whistling. And I needed a whole bunch of whistlers, and we didn't have it. So I said, who can whistle in the production? A few people, including Wes, raised their hands. So I put them out with the violins.
Fabulous.
And then he felt really close to the cue, too. So they
very smart.
They played it well in the movie, and it was great.
Oh, and we have Ghostface staring at us.
That's from the original Scream.
Oh, that's the actual mask?
There was a few of them, but Wes gave me, after we finished, I think the third or fourth
Iconic.
Movie. Yeah.
Did that movie coming out just become your calling card? Did the phone light up?
It all of a sudden I became the horror guy at Dimension, and right after that I did Mimic with Guillermo del Toro. I did Night Watch with Ola Bornedal, a Danish director. I did Halloween H2O. It was a reboot with Jamie Lee Curtis for the Halloween series. I started being like their go-to guy. And that's how I met like Randy Spenlove. I think it was on Scary Movie. It was, the spoofs came out on it, and it really became my entree into learning about the business. And I just thought at that point, all producers and studio heads are this crazy. Because I had nothing to compare them to. Mm. I had no idea that other executives, when they're flying cross country and they ran out of cigarettes, they would land the plane.
Nice.
So, that's just the way. And they would drag me around. You know, I was on the plane with them going to screenings. And I was at my brother's wedding in eastern Long Island, in the middle of the wine country out there. And the next thing, and I'm the best man at the wedding. Next thing I know, my brother's Alexis, he turns and he says, what are those four black SUVs doing in the background? I turn and look, and they had tracked me down from New York, and they said, you need to come back with us.
Are you in the FBI? Or?
You need to come back with us. We're in the middle of a picture, and we're stuck, and we need a score. So I had to leave the wedding and go back to New York in there with them in the SUV. So it was a crazy time, but it was fun.
That's kind of a badass. Yeah, it is.
Thing to happen, though. Like, I got to go with this entourage here. I got to get going.
It's also something that I had a conversation yesterday with a young composer who was complaining that they have something in New York on a Thursday and something in LA on a Saturday, and they don't know how they're going to be able to do something they were just asked to do, which is, could they do one session in Chicago on Friday afternoon? So they're kind of going to pass on it.
What do I think?
I said, dude, you do the New York date, you get up Friday morning, you fly to Chicago, you do the session, you go back to O'Hare, and you're in L.A. Saturday, and welcome to it. If you're in for a penny, you're in for a pound.
Yeah.
And what those...
You have to go full bore.
You got to go full bore. And those guys coming out in their SUVs, why am I not surprised? It's sort of, you've signed up for the gig.
Yeah.
And as we all know, it's almost like with session players, if you pass once and you let the sub go in...
Oh, I wasn't about to do that.
Because if you said, I'm going to stay with my brother's wedding, which would have been a perfectly wonderful and soulful thing to do, they'd say, okay, who's next on the list?
It's the Tom Brady story right there.
Yeah.
Someone goes out, another guy comes in, never see the other guy again.
And never.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't the only time. They tracked me down in a bar once in Santa Monica.
That'll show you. At night, you know.
Were
you wearing a tracker? They seemed to know how to find you.
You would think so. It was really unbelievable. It was sort of a different period. I think
also it was a different period. There was a frenzy in the former era, the 80s, 90s. There was money to throw around. People could land planes to get cigarettes. They'd send jets to pick you up on a set. There was mania. And if we need the composer now, it's not, hey, can you come tomorrow? It's some producer felt empowered to say, find him, bring him back.
Yeah. I mean, I just look at the way my second film, Mimic, we recorded that up at Skywalker. I think we had 6 days with the orchestra and 2 days with the choir and, you know, and unlimited mixing and it, like that now would be on a package. You got to do it in 2 days with 40 pieces, you know, it's like.
So you're feeling the change in feature film budgets and also trickles down to television work as well?
Yeah, I mean, I don't do too much TV, a few things, but it's those, you know, you have a few players. It's not like The Simpsons or something.
Well, you said with The Quiet Place, it was pretty small budget.
Pretty lean. Yeah, it was a small budget. We recorded here that and... I don't know. I had maybe 20 musicians.
How involved was John Krasinski in the score?
He was very involved. He was, everything had to be approved by him. And we started off with a collaboration. He would send me songs that were inspiring to him when he was working on the script. And I would send him music, and he would say, oh, I like this. This is even before we tried anything with picture. Mm. And we would go back and forth like that. And then when we started scoring, he came out here a couple times. I went to New York a couple times to play things. And, it was very, very, he was very involved with it.
Is he musical?
Not in a trained way. He has a sensibility about music, about what's working, what he likes, and what he wants to hear. He's not like a pianist or anything like that. I know his wife, Emily Blunt, has a very musical ear, and she actually, from what he told me, that she responded to some of the music as well. I think he mentioned that she used to play cello, or maybe she still does. So there is music in their family, in their household.
She sings.
And she sings, yeah.
Did you have an idea of the sound of the monster in A Quiet Place? Like you mentioned when you left the theater for iRobot, you were like, I know what I'm going for here. How long did it take for you to develop that sound?
When you say the sound for the monster, there was a very specific sound that the sound department was working on with the way the ear and the monster opened up, which I did not in response to that, I did not know what that would be until they had the visual for that, which was not until I think we were already scoring. So it was like, or a day before we were scoring. So there's a lot of working within that afterwards, because it really was important for the music to work with the sound. But in terms of the sound of the score and what it was going to be, that was something that I definitely had ideas. One of the ideas that I had was that there's no music, there's no sound. Maybe they have a memory of what a piano would sound like, but perhaps it's not accurate. Perhaps there's something out of tune about it.
Isn't there a detuned piano?
So I experimented with that, taking all the black notes on the piano, detuning them by a quarter step.
Freaky deaky.
Oh, it's so terrifyingly good. Were there moments in this movie where maybe you had ideas for score and then decided just to go silent, or vice versa?
Yeah, definitely. It was definitely, it reminded me when I started working on it, almost like a experimental school project. Like there's this concept, we're not going to have sound in the movie, or there's no speaking, there's no dialogue in the movie. So what are we going to do? And you have to try things, you know. Any sound that you make, any musical statement is going to call almost more attention to itself than in a regular movie, because the silence was sort of absolute. And playing with that expectation for what music and sound should do. And I think the sound guys on the movie did an amazing job with that. Being in sync with them, being in sync with what they were doing was very important. So it was a big experiment on everybody's part.
I also hear the Jerry Goldsmith three-note thing. It wasn't three notes exactly, but it's a very simple idea, which is cosmically effective, just hearing the spooky boom, ding, ding. I can't sing it in tune because it's not in tune, but it's sort of, okay, you're going to repeat that? Now you're freaking me out.
Yeah.
Because that, I don't know what those notes are. It's interesting also, I had the thought while I was listening to it this time of, I wonder what that would feel like over the Drew Barrymore scene in Scream. Here you are, I don't know how many years later, making really scary, genuine horror movie music. And is it specific? It's so scary on its own. Would it work over other horror films? I don't know.
Maybe.
I think before.
Well, they're making a number two, right?
They are.
Quiet Place 2.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The movie we did.
I think they're calling it a really quiet place.
A silent place. Yeah, that movie was exploded. I'm sure when you make a movie on that budget and that, nobody expects it to do the numbers that it did. Were you surprised?
Yeah, I was. I mean, I think everybody thought when the movie was done, because everybody put a lot into it, that it was something special. But even so, it was a really nice surprise.
And Free Solo.
Yeah. Speaking of horror.
So I think that's actually, I have to say, the scariest movie I've ever done.
That's amazing. That's really remarkable to hear. And I totally understand why, because
I was sweating.
I was too. Yeah. And I've gone to horror movies and you kind of jump, or, you know, whoever you're with maybe buries their head in your shoulder. Oh, I can't watch this. Yeah. Free Solo, I looked down and my palms were drenched. I was really sweating.
I've been in the theater with Alex, the climber, next to me, and I'm still sweating. Like, is the guy going to survive?
I watched interviews with him before I saw the movie, and I'm like, I know he's alive. What is wrong with me?
Yeah.
But God, just knowing that, and then there's those little moments where his foot slips, and you're just like, oh God.
Yeah.
When you first saw that film, there's got to be a million things running through your mind. There's beautiful scenery, but there's also this frightening real-life danger.
And there's an emotional relationship at the core.
There's all kinds of things going on in that.
documentaries are funny because a lot of the story, you know, they weren't sure how it was all, who knew how the relationship was going to work out. And they were filming this thing. I actively pursued this because I was such a fan of Jimmy Chin, the filmmaker, yeah, from his last movie, Meru. I don't know if
I saw it,
which, you know, was about climbing this peak,
yeah,
in the Himalayas, which is maybe technically like the most difficult. It's not the highest, but
second or third highest mountain. And
yeah, and being totally in awe of this guy, and just when hearing that he was making Free Solo, I'm not a climber. I don't know anything about it, but I really wanted to meet him. I wanted to get inside his head. I wanted to see what makes him tick. And one of the greatest parts of the movie was going there and spending 2 days with Jimmy and Chai, his wife, and just talking about the process. And
where's there?
In New York.
Oh.
And being totally inspired by the whole thing. And
did they have the movie completely assembled for you to show you?
They had an assembly, but it changed. It changed a lot because it was really hard in that opening cut that they had for someone that's not a climber to get a sense of the danger and everything that went into it. So they went back, and now in the beginning of the movie, they talk about the history of the mountain, all the people that have, mm-hmm, tried climbing, the problems, the problem areas on the mountain, the potential pitfalls, all the stuff, which wasn't in originally, or it wasn't, mm-hmm, in the way it is now.
Smart.
And I remember seeing it and being a little bit like wanting to know more. Mm-hmm. I was like, because I'm not a climber, and all these guys, everyone that made the movie, everyone that shot the movie, they're all climbers, so they take it for granted. So I remember talking to them about that, and then we sort of went on hiatus. I started working on ideas. I had an idea right after seeing that movie too. But as I was working on it, they were reconfiguring the thing. And then I think like 8 months later, I got a completely new picture.
Huh.
Did you go out to Yosemite?
No, I've never been there.
Really?
No.
It's even scarier when you've seen those cliffs in person. It's like, I can't even imagine.
I did do a VR Yosemite thing that they had, and I couldn't stand up. I had to sit down, otherwise I'd fall over.
What
a fabulous piece of music.
The closing of this film with the music and the visuals and everything, oh man, it's just when he's completing the climb, it's just incredible.
It's you feel good for him after this.
It must have been freaky shooting this, knowing that this may not end happy.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I mean, I think that's one of the interesting things about this doc is that it sort of faces these existential questions right in it. They're like, we're filming this. What are we going to do if? Yeah.
I think they say it.
They say it.
Well, one guy feels badly that he may be witnessing his pal's demise.
Well, and they had to.
And the cinematographer couldn't even look through the lens.
Right. They had to restructure the way they laid out the cinematographers at a certain point, right? Because they were worried they were going to screw him up.
Right. Yeah. They didn't want to have him distracted.
Yeah. Yeah, which, could you imagine? Being the cameraman who sneezed when he. Oh. That's just as nerve-wracking. I felt just as bad for the camera people, yeah, as a cinematographer. I was like, I don't even, those guys are focused on him, but they're also like hanging from the side of a mountain. That whole project just made me want to throw up.
Yeah. That theme also, I realized today, it's kind of epic, and also there's a little Americana, there's a little the out west feeling. It's not necessarily Copeland, but it's sort of it's the elegy of what it is that guy's doing. It's a very, this is the pioneer who is going to look in uncharted lands, and that theme sort of could almost be at the end of a Western. Hmm. And I heard it for the first time here. I know you did 310 to Yuma, and you've done some Westerns.
Well, thank you.
But it's a really that thematic thing sort of is a heartfelt end of a kind of romantic epic American saga, which is Free Solo was.
Yeah.
And it won the Oscar.
Yeah. And I remember right after I saw the movie, I climbed the stairs in my house really carefully. I just thought, I don't want to slip.
That's what I thought about. I'm like, my danger is that I might stab myself with a pencil, you know, when I'm writing some music. And these guys are, you know, on the side of a cliff.
Right. I might butt dial somebody unintentionally.
Yeah. We all have our things that make us scared. I mean, you ride a motorcycle. I wouldn't do it.
You still riding your bike?
Every Sunday, I go to the track with my son.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
That's so cool. Well, Marco, it's been amazing to have this conversation. As I said, we've worked together and done stuff, but I always learn, and I always feel slightly amazed by what you do, because it's very clear when you say, oh, I had an idea. You had to come away and create something out of nothing when you saw those movies. You had to go home and make something exist that didn't exist before the screening. And that, hats off.
That's why we don't sleep.
Yeah, no kidding.
And we're excited for Ford v. Ferrari. That comes out in theaters in November?
I think November.
And what reviews it's getting. Can't wait. Boy, that's going to be a huge one. Another huge one.
Fox, I missed seeing you there.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. As I say to my wife, 7 years ago, I had an instinct it was time to go. Because, you know, now that it's all been bought by Disney, boy, did I see the writing on the walls. Just another 7 years, and I better get out now.
Well, Marco, we want to thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks for dragging your butts out here.
Oh, it was a beautiful drive.
Yeah, beautiful drive.
We loved it. This has been Score the Podcast, presented by Spitfire Audio. We want to thank composer Carol for helping us out. Robert Kraft, we want to remind our listeners to rate and review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts, and to subscribe if you like what you're hearing. And also stick around after this ending. We're going to play you a little cue from Spitfire to show you how you can elevate your music. Robert.
Hey, man. What a great treat to be at PNLA. Marco, a million thanks. And I'll see you at the World Soundtrack Awards coming up in October.
Awesome. Thanks.
We'll see you next week. Hey, Score listeners, we're so excited for the support of Spitfire Audio partnering with us here at Score the Podcast. Oh, wow. You like that, Robert?
I like that. Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
They collaborate with people like Hans Zimmer, the Bernard Herrmann Estate, and now the BBC Symphony to create these sample packages and libraries to elevate your music.
And if you want to jump in on an incredible offer, is it one-third off, Kenny?
It is one-third off. The promo code is SCORE. And right now we're going to play you a cue that they provided us to hear some of the different types of sounds in the Spitfire Audio packages. Check it out. You can get all sorts of different sounds in their packages and sample libraries. Just go to spitfireaudio.com, check out their selection, and remember, this promo code SCORE is exclusive to our listeners, so take advantage of the deal while it lasts. I thought you were going to say something.
I am. I'm saying yes, baby.
Yeah. We're leaving this in. You had your finger up like, I have a point to make.
This is a good deal. Yes, baby.
And that t-shirt does not come with your order.
That's just right. So you know.
SpitfireAudio.com. Check it out. Use the promo code SCORE and save a third off. We'll see you next week.